Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is the SpongeBob SquarePants Movie, made in 2004 by THQ for Windows-based computers. Based on the long-running cartoon series on Nickelodeon, SpongeBob SquarePants finally hit the big screen in 2004, thanks to parent company Paramount and Nickelodeon Pictures. The movie did quite well, taking in over $85 million when all was said and done, and SpongeBob SquarePants seemed to be here to stay. The film would continue on with the wacky and nonsensical situations based around the yellow-colored, square-shaped sponge creature, along with his best friend, Patrick the Starfish. The two get into all sorts of adventures and trouble, not caring what others think of their bizarre behavior all the while. There weren't too many big stars found within this film, but at least all the familiar voices from the show, along with the other stars that they brought in for this movie. As the now famous voice of SpongeBob SquarePants, we have longtime animated voice actor Tom Kenny. Making a cameo as a real-life version of himself in this cartoon is David Hasselhoff. Voicing the hired thug and strongman Dennis is famous and well-known TV and movie actor Alec Baldwin. Wacky and comedic off-the-wall actor Jeffrey Tambor portrays the powerful King Neptune. The movie starts out with the title star of the film waking up out of bed, excited about the prospects of becoming the new manager of the newly opened Krusty Krab 2. Upon arriving at the big celebration to name the new manager, owner and boss Mr. Krabs makes SpongeBob's neighbor, Squidward, manager instead. Meanwhile, the small and evil Plankton wants to take over Bikini Bottom with the use of his Plan Z. Plankton sneaks into King Neptune's castle and steals his crown. Plankton then frames Mr. Krabs for taking it, and King Neptune punishes the crab. Reluctantly, King Neptune agrees to allow SpongeBob to retrieve the crown, but only gives him 6 days' time. SpongeBob and Patrick now take on the challenge to venture all the way to Shell City and to save his boss from this icy fate. They venture off in the paddy wagon together as Plankton starts to put his evil plan into motion, using mind control buckets to take over everyone's minds in Bikini Bottom. Our would-be heroes have to deal with huge monsters at the bottom of the chasms, as well as hired thug Dennis, who is on their trail trying to stop them from getting the crown back. It's a non-stop romp from location to location as SpongeBob and Patrick race against time to save Bikini Bottom and Mr. Krabs while meeting many friends along the way. It's a movie that should entertain fans of all ages with its fun story, music, and situations. It's the last game to be reviewed based off of the SpongeBob SquarePants movie, and we finish it off with the computer version. Will it finish things off as the big catch of the day, or be just another meal to be served at the Chum Bucket as leftovers? I'll tell you now as we get on to the review. Once again, we have another game that takes things in a different path for a computer-based version. We have a game aiming for a younger target audience, unlike its portable and console counterparts. And it's surprising, as this is released at a time when computers were able to match consoles quite well. The SpongeBob SquarePants Movie game for the PC is a point-and-click adventure, released on Windows-based computers. There are a few playable characters in this game, with you as the player directing SpongeBob SquarePants for most of the game's 8 chapters. There are also select stages devoted to using Plankton and Mindy, and even moments where Patrick Star is playable. But most of the game will have you using the title star as the main character whose actions you are directly influencing. You will be clicking about while item hunting, question asking, screen exploring, and engaging in character interacting moments that sorta kinda follow the events of the movie's storyline. The only action you need to do in this game is point the mouse at various parts of the screen to either click on items, locations, or people. The screen will have text appear when something you are clicking on is part of the action that you can interact with. Through the various 8 chapters, we relive the 6-day adventure from Bikini Bottom to Shell City to retrieve the King's lost crown, of course stretching things out greatly, and adding in a lot of elements that had nothing at all to do with the movie. The object of the game is to figure out how to get through each chapter by interacting with the right items and people to get the proper chain of events to happen, so that you can move on to the next part of the stage properly and complete it. Since it's a kids' point-and-click game, the options were very limiting, and the only thing you can lose in this game is your patience if you have trouble figuring something out. Loading up this game will give you only one moment of action, and that has Plankton speeding across the ocean before it fades to the title screen. No other story or moments are to be found here, as a simple and mostly static select screen will then load up to give the player limited choices on what they can do next. You can either start a game, load a previously saved one, or change sound and video options. Starting a new game gets things going instantly. We zoom in on an empty ship and the captain's quarters that has a book upon it that will tell the story of SpongeBob's adventures from the movie. This is how the game will provide storyline and backgrounds to connect everything we are about to do to the moments of the movie itself, and said book moments will show up in between each level to further connect things as we play. After finishing the brief synopsis, you start chapter 1, called Love Thy Neighbor, which will give the player full control of SpongeBob as he waits for the player to direct him further in his own house. And the starting moments of this stage, of course, will get you used to how the game will progress from here on in. SpongeBob, having just awoken from his deep sleep, is excited about a new promotion at the Krusty Krab 2. You have to help him get ready for the big day by getting him dressed and brushing his teeth properly so he is clean and ready to go. Of course, said actions will require a bit of other tasks to be performed first beforehand, leading to a chain of events and item collecting that in turn you will have to use so he can properly go from his bed to getting his teeth brushed before heading to work. You have limited things that you are able to click on this starting screen as you move the mouse cursor about. So by clicking on his pet snail Gary, for instance, you are given choices of things you can say to him. Each phrase can be cycled through and should give more information on what you are supposed to do next, and this will be similar to how you deal with most character interactions in the entire game's run. Cycle through each of the phrases available to select from. Each character will then have a bit of banter back and forth, as said text will then clue you in on what your next goal is to progress further. Once you have said everything available to the characters, you end the conversation with them and move on to other areas of the room or level to see what else you can find next. Besides speaking to characters, you can also pick up items. And again, you can only interact with things that have text that shows up on the bottom, with everything else just looking nice in the background. So in SpongeBob's room, you can pick up his alarm clock and add it to your inventory for later usage. Of course, you won't know what you need it for yet, but if you're able to pick something up, rest assured it will be used at some point during this level. And the items that you pick up make up for the only screen menu that you will interact with or see during this game's run. After picking up various items on the stage, it will be available in said menu, at the top of the screen. You right-click the mouse button to open it up, and you can drag and move the item to other things on the screen in the hopes of getting it to do proper actions that are needed to move on further. If the item is the right one, it will put the next chain of events into motion. If it's not, SpongeBob will tell you flat out that it doesn't go there, and it remains in your menu.
I don't think so.
There will be moments where you can combine items into new items through said menu as well. By the end of any given stage, each item will have to have been used somewhere for you to be able to end the stage. There is no life system, no lives, no hit points, no score, no anything. It's a very linear game where you can click about for as long as you want until you figure out what you have to do next without worry of losing the game or having to do things all over again. Also found on any stage are things that don't do anything at all, but you can still click on them. And these items will have SpongeBob say random comments in relation to it, but really have no other purpose. Meaning these items aren't important in relation to the chapter, but may make for an interesting or amusing quip. Lastly, you can exit each room by moving the mouse to the corner or the bottom of the screen, and moving to the next part of the house by doing so. And in the new room, you can interact with more items and see if you can find other things to collect and interact with. You can also exit the house and walk to Squidward and Patrick's houses. The whole feel of the game is weird in that the game is constantly breaking the fourth wall. SpongeBob is talking directly to the player at many points when he describes items or tells you when you did something that didn't work. Like if you click on pictures in his house, he will tell you that they are bland and dull.
These pictures are really bland. I want to see sharks or electric eels or something like that.
The first level plays out easily enough, but all levels, truth be told, aren't anything difficult if you can point and click and search about the limited areas you are given to do so. But it's mostly just go to a few rooms, find a few items, go to another room, see if you can talk to the right people who need a certain item, a lot of back and forth, walking all over the place, randomly clicking things until you make the right things happen in the few limited screens each level will offer. At the end of each level, it goes back to the pirate ship with the storybook, and the narrator will talk about the moments out of the movie itself that we are now about to go to story-wise. Using still captures as pictures and some voiceovers, and some vocals will be overset pictures to tie it in better. And then it just goes to the next level and you do the same routine all over again. I honestly wish there was more to the game, but that's all there is here. Its connection to the movie itself gets very lost the deeper you get into this. And the fact that you can actually get items before you even know what you will do with them was just lazy on the programmer's part. Why is he carrying around his alarm clock or an ice cube before he even knows what he plans on doing with said items? There are many items all over the place that he could randomly carry around in the hopes that they may come in handy. In most games, you have to realize you need something before it becomes available to pick up. This one just lets you get anything and everything, and if you had it while it came up, that's great. If you didn't, no big deal, just go and get it and continue on. The whole setup just seems strange to me. There are no enemies or confrontations or real challenging situations to ever deal with in this entire game. Everyone, even the bullies, are as nice as can be. And you can't really lose this game, as all you're doing is clicking on anything everywhere, and there's no penalty for doing something wrong, as the game just waits for you to figure out what you're supposed to do next. I understand these games are great for the younger audience, and there are many like it out there. But did there have to be one made based on this movie exactly? I just don't get the point. Each level will visit a location from the film, and some do the situations well, while others just make up a totally different story in locations that had nothing to do with anything from this movie. You have movie-related places such as Bikini Bottom and the Krusty Krab 1 and 2, as well as Chum Bucket, then off to Goofy Goobers and the Biker Bar, followed by the Deep Trench and of course Shell City, and then back to Bikini Bottom that is now known as Planktopolis. These locations are all fine and fit well, even if what you're doing in said locations were weird and strange when compared to the actual plot of the film. But this game stretched things out so much, you get locations that are weird at best. I can live with the fact that they made a whole chapter devoted to Plankton stealing the crown from the palace, and making a mission out of it can actually work in the context of it. But later on, we have a full chapter devoted to Mindy sneaking out of the same palace after she was grounded. And later levels will have underwater trench moments that are turned into weird missions that have nothing to do with Dennis pursuing them or even showing any of the giant monsters that live below. Instead, you are visiting a hotel trying to find a lost item, and then even going to a cave to get an item that will clear up fog that's blocking your path to the next stage. Follow that by another level that has our would-be hero visiting a chiropractor, and then a surplus store as he's trying to get to the bottom of protests taking place due to invertebrates not allowed to get the services of said chiropractor due to their having no spine for him to even look at. So yeah, to say that this game took big deviations and liberties with the movie's plot and story is a huge understatement. There were a few moments that took some deviations in the game from the usual point and click and free exploring that most of the game had. There's no vehicle moments or David Hasselhoff situations like other games had based on this game. But one part of an early stage will have Plankton flying towards the castle to steal the crown, and you have to avoid jellyfish in your way by flying above or below them as they come across the screen at differing speeds. The only penalty for getting hit too many times is having to attempt to do it over again, and like most things in this game, it's nothing too difficult that will be of any trouble for most players. Other deviation type moments take place toward the end of the game, where you have to enter the Chum Bucket as SpongeBob and avoid a SpongeBob robot who is guarding it. Your goal is to collect all the Krabby Patties on the floor while avoiding the robot who is trying to get to you as you do so. Get all the Krabby Patties off the floor and the door to the lab opens up so you can get a needed item. They also have deviations when you're exploring the cave in another moment of the game, where it had a memory type of game where you had to remember the pattern of colors and walk in the right paths based on those colors. Then look into a magic pool in the next room that'll tell the future so you would know which path to choose at the end to get the item you were looking for. Your only penalty for doing anything wrong is being sent back to the start of the cave to have to do it again. But anything you did complete, you won't have to repeat and you can merely walk back through it to get to the farthest point that you're up to. So yeah, the game had some other things and variation moments, but not only was it far and few in between, it was also so simplistic that it almost came off as an afterthought. Like the developers needed to come up with some other ways to add more of a level variety for the sake of variety, even if the connection to the movie was lost in all of this. The game itself looks great graphically though. The look and feel of the characters, level, and designs are all impressive for such a generic game. Everyone looked exactly as they should, whether it was SpongeBob, Patrick, Mindy, Plankton, and each sounding exactly right, with the proper voice actors providing their vocals. Some of the voice acting was a bit on the lackluster side though, truth be told, with all these new and generic characters they came up with to fill in the extra moments of this game, all sounding like someone put little effort into making these vocals sound proper in connection to the real characters that are found in this game. So you have someone doing a French accent.
We are protesting on their treatment at the hands of the chiropractic overlords.
A disinterested receptionist.
So, you have no spine. no bones. How can you be treated by a back doctor if you have no back?
Or even a stuck-up hotel clerk.
No, I was kidding. What are you, some kind of knucklehead McSpasmatron?
All sounding with as little effort as possible. And the vocals were important as they were constant and your clue to where and what you were supposed to do to get through this game. All the main characters from the movie sounded spot on. I can't say the same for these made-up characters squeezed into this game. The cutscene moments and book on the boat moments were done well enough and were all presented so that it was clear to see the story of the movie through this method. And with the use of actual stills from the movie, it worked well and looked as it should. David Hasselhoff's name was edited out of this game, and even his likeness was removed, even though his moment is still in the game in a cutscene. So it's very strange how they went about the whole situation, actually. Patrick was also a character who was with SpongeBob at many times in this game, but seemed to only be there because he was so in the movie, and serves no real purpose to his actually being there, as SpongeBob is the only one you're really doing anything with at many moments. It seemed like they couldn't wait to get those two separated at many moments during gameplay, so you can go back to just having SpongeBob solo searching about as Patrick leaves for ridiculous reasons. The only moment you get to use Patrick is in a short moment in Shell City. It's such a short-lived and quick moment that Patrick goes right back to being background fodder once the moment ends. You can actually talk to Patrick when he's in your party, but he'll just say the same repeated banter back and forth and offer nothing to help you further in the level. The game will only take about 3 to 4 hours to get through, and that's for a first-time player, of course. Most of the long periods of the game are just due to you walking from point to point, and SpongeBob doesn't seem to be any rush to go where he's going, that's for sure. There isn't much I can say on controls. If you can point and click both buttons of your mouse, you'll be just fine. The game is truly the definition of point and click. Everything reacted right away when you clicked on it, and highlighted easily for you to see what you were hovering over. Controls don't get much simpler than that. The game will come near an end as you get to Chapter 8, Planktopolis. And like in the movie, it has SpongeBob and Patrick returning from Shell City with the King's Crown. And now SpongeBob must break Plankton's mind control over everybody by playing music on his guitar in the Krusty Krab. He will learn all this by talking to a musician who is standing outside of the Krusty Krab and tells him what's required to break the mind control. So, first he has to infiltrate the chump bucket to get a reverse polarity subether frequency emitter. And he has to get through the before mentioned deviation moment where he collects Krabby Patties while avoiding a robot that looks just like him. So, back at the Krusty Krab, the musician has suddenly been taken over by the bucket helmet. So now SpongeBob will take his guitar from him into his inventory and head into the Krusty Krab storeroom to get a speaker to add to the musician's amplifier. You put all these items together, plug it in, and the game will give you one more deviation moment for you to have to play through. You get a guitar minigame that has you playing guitar with multicolored strings and notes that match said colors. As the notes drop down onto the screen, you have to click on the color screen matching the note as the same color note touches it. Do this right and you add a point to your meter. So you continue to do this as many times as you can until the meter fills up fully and you complete the game, just like that. You are treated to the final cutscene moment showing the end of the movie, and the credits roll as a familiar song plays throughout it. Well, it's short and to the point, this game. Not much more to say here.
I'm a goofy goober! You're a goofy goober! We're all goofy goobers! Goofy, goofy, goober, goober!
It's a match. The music in this game is weird in that it's subtle and in the background, but unique to each location. Nothing really matched up to the film, actually, music-wise, but the music was nice enough, and it fit the moments well enough either way. Goofy Goober Rock will show up, though, as an end-credit song after you beat the game. Not during it, actually. Which again makes the whole usage of said song strange and awkward, just like most things found in this game came off it. It was a great way to finish the game to have the song going as you see the credits scroll, and a perfect rendition of it nonetheless. But it really would have been much cooler if said song is actually playing while you're doing the guitar moment at the end of the game, and are trying to play that song. Other stages, like when you're visiting the Goofy Goober ice cream shop, should have had the Goofy Goober song in the background. And there were many other moments where music from the film could have been utilized properly. I'm glad they got the iconic song in it at least at the end of the game, but that was the only time in this game they had any accurate music from the film. Well, I definitely was not a fan of this game. It was catering to a totally different target market, for one thing, and for another, its connection to the movie and point in existing as a movie-based game are real problems here. Nothing wrong with making a fun point-and-click adventure for the kids as a PC-based game based off of SpongeBob SquarePants, but it didn't work when trying to connect it to this film, as well as the console and even the not-so-great portable versions do it. There are a lot of drawbacks found in this game that really will hold it back. There's no real challenge or excitement found at any time in this game, for one thing. You can get items whenever you want, even if you don't need them yet, or know what to do with them. You're trapped in limited screens with limited options of what you can do, making things very simplistic. Some of the vocals of the generic characters are lifeless and seem phoned in by those who did them. The story is so lost here, you wonder how some of this is even connected to anything in the film. They have you going to a doctor's office and exploring the king's castle, as well as a hotel and a cave. I didn't even know what game I was playing at sometimes during these points. You can't do anything wrong, really, and all you have to do is talk to everyone, click on everything, click on every message possible, find every item around, and that's it. I think even for kids, this is quite easy and lifeless. I understand what they were going for here, and do think it could have worked, but whatever they did, here, it didn't work. It's 3 or so hours that I think kids will get bored of quickly, and there are many good point-and-click adventures for kids to play with. I don't think this is one that was on top of the list for must-play adventures at school when this was out. Avoid this one, as obviously the console version is the way to go if you want a fun adventure that relates well to the movie. As for this one, it does indeed belong in the chum bucket as yesterday's leftover, as you won't find much appetizing here. Well, this is the last game based off this film that is to be reviewed. And for the most part, it was an interesting assortment of games that differ greatly through each version. Hopefully, any future games based off of SpongeBob movies to be reviewed here will bring forth more interesting results. But as far as this point-and-click adventure goes, it's going to wind up getting the underwhelming score of... That's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a movie review.